I have to bring you a bit of a sad part, which is a warning. It's not, oh, this seriously wrong podcast is so light and funny, it has nothing important to say. No, my claim would be the opposite. Seriously Wrong is the most dangerous podcast of all podcasts. It is violent and so on and so on.
Yep.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to the Seriously Wrong podcast. I'm Sean.
And I am Aaron.
And the Seriously Wrong podcast is the only podcast in the entire universe that traveled back in time to give you the tools to survive the near future.
So we got a game. We got a game to play this week.
Yeah, we like games here. We like having fun and playing and games.
Playing games, changing games.
Yeah, creating games.
Rewriting the game rules.
Just fooling around. Playing around.
Yeah.
So we had this article that someone sent to us called Let's Play Žižuku, which is from talkingphilosophy.com, Julian Beghini, which I'll just read the basic premise of this game. I have invented a new game called Žižuku. The rules are simple. Pick any widely received idea and create the most clever sounding way to invert it as so to create a paradox, or at least the semblance of one. The game, of course, is inspired by Slavoj Zizek. Reviewing his latest book for Times Higher Education, I realized that this is really almost all that he does. So pick any widely received idea and find the most clever sounding way to invert it as to create a paradox.
I'm excited. I'm a little bit scared. I feel like I haven't listened to enough of Zizek. Like, I've heard some of him, but I'm worried I'm gonna do it wrong.
If anything, you should be afraid you'll do it too right.
Oh, okay.
Right. And the quality of the episode relies on us breaking from this format in occasion to keep diversity. So if you have any fear, it should be the opposite.
So yeah, sit back.
So here we go.
Because you're going to be hearing a lot more of that coming up.
If anything, I think you should sit forward and
embrace yourself.
It's not a time to relax. It's time to ignite your fight or flight response so you can. What this episode is going to be an assault on your conceptions of the world. These clever inversions can be acidic to the cores of our thinking, will be under attack. So don't sit back and relax. No, the opposite. Sit forward and embrace yourself, because your ideas of the world are about to be challenged.
I am wrong. You are wrong. We are wrong. I am wrong.
This episode is not brought to you by, oh, this is some sort of clever inversion of some advertising tropes. No, this is my funny idea on this. If irony is the private refuge of the slaves, as it were, what we need is Andy Kaufman is making a joke that will not make us laugh now, no, but my claim would be it makes our children and the future laugh at the joke being played on us now. An Andy Kaufman of politics who attacks our apathy and our absence of solidarity. The episode is not sponsored by this. No, precisely the opposite.
One nice example of fetishism would have been this big influence of New Age ideology, like what I ironically call Western Buddhism. You know how even top managers in the United States today, they like Buddhism as their justification. The way they perceive the situation is, oh, all my financial activity, my business, this is just superficial, it's all a social game. The truth of my personality is in my mystical experience, and so on. In reality, it's exactly the opposite. Your mystical experience, or whatever your inner journey, is a mask, something that you construct, that you live, so that it is easier for you to work on the market. Which is why I claim that some kind of vague oriental spirituality is becoming the predominant form of ideology. This is why, for example, Dalai Lama is so popular in the West. What he Promises is some kind of enlightened hedonism, in the sense of follow our way, do a little bit of meditation, and your life will be much more relaxed. You will be able to enjoy it without getting into too many traumatic experiences and so on and so on.
I want to start, I think, with the premise of A is A.
Oh yeah, basics. Getting
this
I like
is a
this.
Basic.
Yeah.
Nice. So this is an objectivist meme, right?
Yeah. It actually comes from Aristotle originally, and just like when he was laying out, I can't remember his work on logic and identity, and just like he started from those same basics, and Ayn Rand took it and put it also in her stuff in Atlas Shrugged, and was purportedly doing the same thing, building her entire philosophy from this basic starting point of A is A. So if you accept A is A, then you therefore accept self-interest, capitalism, and all those things.
See, I think this is precisely the point within Ayn Rand's philosophy where she stepped off base and it sent her down the round track.
Yeah.
Because when she thought that A is A, like, sure, obviously A is A in the superficial sense. I mean, A is A. It refers to itself.
Yeah, when you're typing a word, it doesn't matter if you put A in there or A, you'll have the same outcome.
Maybe the important thing is not to say whether or not A is A, because this is nonsense, but the claim of A is that A is A alone, which is incorrect. A is A within the context of the alphabet and the language. So its context is also important. Its context is probably of greater importance than A is A itself.
So in order for A to mean anything, it has to be with B, C, D, E, F, G, all the way down.
And without that, A isn't A. A is just nothing.
In the sense that everything is a fractal and each individual contains the all within it. A is not just A. A contains everything or is contained within everything, and those have the same meaning. And so that's what Ayn Rand doesn't get, that the individual exists within the context of all the others.
Yeah, it's a great microcosm for the the primary critique of Ayn Rand.
Yeah, you went off base there, Aristotle, Ayn.
Or maybe it's the opposite. It's not that Ayn Rand made her mistake at the very beginning, but that Ayn Rand's only mistake was to not see the light by the end of her life and ask for forgiveness to change her ways. Like perhaps her entire career was perfect just the way it was, but the only time that she messed up, the exact moment she went off course, was when she didn't broaden her perspectives in the end of her life.
I buy it. I buy that that's the case.
So it's not the root of her philosophy, it's the exact opposite.
Yeah, in the same way that she probably didn't actually just first start out thinking, okay, is A, and what comes from that? And then, she had her biases in favor of capitalism against communism because of her life experiences, and she went back and built the philosophy. So the mistake was made at the end in both cases. The mistake was made not in the foundation, but in what was built to, because she built it backwards. I don't know if what I'm saying makes exact sense, but I think it does.
Well, people claim they want exact sense all the time, but I would say the opposite. What we need is inexact sense that splatters paint on the canvas and can be read later. People would say something as simple as 1 + 1 = 2. Self-evidently true? ? No. It's not. There's two ways in which this isn't true. When we're choosing to use the words 1 + 1 rather than just saying 2, in the first place, what we're describing is a delineation or demarcation between these ones. And in this original example, there's still individuals. It could be, for example, 1 banana + 1 apple = 2 fruit. But in the act of saying 2 fruit, you have erased the identity of the banana and the apple. Your information has decayed. So in the original example of 1 banana and 1 apple, what you have is 2 individuals and you have more information. In another sense in which 1 + 1 = 2 is we are assuming that 1 represents only 1, that 1 is not a rounded whole number for simplicity, when in reality it could equal 1.3. If 1 is a round down from 1.3, then 1.3 + 1.3 = 3. So 2.6, which is then rounded up to 3. So when we assume that 1 + 1 = 2 contains all of the information that's required to determine whether or not it's true, we are being misled.
Even in math, interpretation is necessary. You can never just assume that the facts are straightforward and as they seem to be, and you can never assume that all the relevant information is contained in the abstraction, in the math numbers, in the 1 + 1 = 2. You always have to look under the surface, look a little deeper into things to get a fuller picture.
But I would claim the opposite. It's not that we need to look deeper and to find out what is really going on. I think we should do the opposite. We should look at a wider scale and see what is not going on. What is going on can be misleading. It limits our imagination. If we take a wider view and look at what's not going on, we can better investigate the realities of the world, including mathematics.
So one of the ones I wanted to read was that we live on a planet with finite resources. Our economic system requires infinite growth. So you can't have infinite growth on a planet with finite resources. I think that it is exactly the opposite, and that our economic system doesn't require growth. It requires destruction of resources, and that we don't have finite resources. We have infinite resources, but we are unable to tap them and to find new ways of getting into them precisely because our economic system requires destruction and not growth. And what we need is an economic system that requires growth and that grows our resources and grows our ability to expand what is possible with the physical resources we have, ways to get resources from off planet, ways to turn our minds into resources. We can generate resources through our creativity, through our thoughts and the way we implement them in the world. And we need an economy that is truly based on this kind of growth. Because when we're talking about growth in our economy today, often what we're talking about is the measure of how much destruction this economy has been doing to the planet. That is not a measure of growth, that's a measure of destruction. And so that's why it's perfectly the opposite.
One way I've heard this framed, this is a slight paraphrase, but our economic system treats inheritances as if it's income. When we look around at the resource wealth of the world, we spend it gleefully as if it's our paycheck rather than looking at it as something as wealth that's been amassed, excess that's floating around. We assume that it's excess, but in reality it's...
Right.
But maybe what would be truly revolutionary is to reverse that, to further blur the lines between inheritance and income for the average person, where the premise of the Thomas Paine's citizen's dividend, where we are paid from the inheritance of the earth, that our paycheck comes from the natural wealth, our shared inheritance is our paycheck.
Most people are having their inheritance withheld from them. So all this wealth is tied up in these certain people get it.
Because they made a fence around the place where the resources were.
Yeah. And like we're imagining inheritance as something that comes through bloodlines, not something that everyone is entitled to for existing.
Yeah, so the common sense would be that inheritance is something that goes down through generations. Oh, my dad had money, now I get money, and my son will get money, and so on and so on. But the reality is actually the opposite, that we are all inheriting a situation together, the world.
Yeah, that system is preventing inheritance. It's a system of preventing natural inheritance from taking place. When you are able to take any of the resources you've walled off and give them all to your offspring without regard for the Lockean proviso, the idea that your property is only your property if there is as much and as good for others. Otherwise, the claim does not hold. We all, by virtue of being born, have a stake in the planet and have a stake in benefiting from the resources of this planet. And we need to start thinking in terms of what it is that we are all inheriting and how to put that into the real world.
So, yeah, in a truly revolutionary future, there would be no inheritance as we understand it. There would be no false demiurge of inheritance, the false god of this bloodline inheritance. Instead, a more generalized and open idea of inheritance that's authentic and more reflective of reality.
Yeah, exactly. So you know how people say that life is suffering, it's a Buddhist phrase, that life is suffering, I think that it's exactly wrong, and that is the problem. We're wanting to say that the problem is with life and with how life is, but we spend all of our time, all of our energy looking for ways to make ourselves suffer. What we need to do is to not want to suffer, and then we won't need to make ourselves suffer, and then we can see life for what it is, which is something that isn't inherently sufferable.
It's not that life is putting suffering onto us, it's that we're putting suffering onto life.
Yeah, and this is an old Stoic idea. Like you can have pain, but you don't have to suffer more than feeling the sensation of the pain. It's not actually life. The suffering is coming from you.
And maybe the person, they're saying, oh, I'm suffering now. I'm truly alive. I know that I'm alive. But it's actually the opposite in those moments. They're
the most disconnected from life that they could be.
They're refusing to live in the moments they're suffering.
Yeah.
You said something crucial. This is maybe the fundamental message. When something appears to be undermining the system or subverting it, look at it closely. Maybe at a deeper level, it's part of the system. That's the big lesson I took from my socialist youth. I mean, when I was living in a communist country. How, you know, black market and all those things that those in power were officially fighting, well, that's what enabled people to survive. Precisely through those illegal activities, the system maintained itself in a viable state.
A common claim around leftists and activists and political people who are disenfranchised in the world right now is this concept that money is the root of all evil, or that money is this horrible problem, and that we would be better without money. My claim would be the opposite, that no money is the root of all evil. The absence of money is when we start to see the suffering and pain of individuals. People who do have money actually have quite wonderful lives. And so taking this to a societal level, to abolish or get rid of money as a political struggle, is to risk the experience of being moneyless. And what I would advocate for is the opposite, to make more money and give money to as many people as possible, to flood the market of money. And people will claim, oh, when you print this money, what you're going to do is make money worth less to everyone. This is such a horrible disaster. Oh my God, milk will cost $7. Can you imagine the price of gasoline under what you're advocating for? And I would say, yes, I can imagine those things. And yes, you're right. But it's not a bad thing. It's actually the opposite, because Thomas Piketty, who I respect and admire, made a crucial mistake in his claim that we need to tax wealth worldwide as a way to pay for social services around the world. While I agree with the spirit of his claim, I think that this in practice would become a bureaucratic nightmare. The easy way around this to tax wealth is to increase the amount of wealth in the system as a hidden flat tax that encourages people to spend their money. It creates negative interest rates. So people will spend their money, and the money, the new money that comes into the system comes to the poor and the needy. So not only is money not the root of all evil, but by printing money, we will increase wealth and value for everyone.
So the poor people aren't going to be the ones affected by the printing of money, because all the money that's being printed is going to be going to them. They're going to be affected positively. The people who are going to be negatively affected by each dollar holding less and less worth very quickly over time as inflation goes up is the people who have these vast stockpiles of dollars, who see the value of their stockpile very quickly dropping as we pump up, inflate the currency, then it'll just like reach an equilibrium when we've sort of...
It increases entrepreneurship, positive spending and experimentation to transition from the crisis state we find ourselves in. It prevents people sitting on money, which is bad for the economy. It decreases the monetary velocity. Some would claim that in my utopia that I've drawn, I've made the crucial mistake of undervaluing the amount of resource wealth, land ownership, and property ownership that the ultra-rich have, and these things will actually go up in value. They don't hold their money in cash, they hold it in assets, and that will actually go up under my system. But I would claim that they've made the mistake, and the opposite is true. The increased monetary velocity in the system would create new commodities, increase the chances of exploring to the stars and getting more resources, which would create a commodity inflation, where the price of methane goes down because there's more methane available, supply and demand. this amount of financial stimulation would increase the amount of commodities in the market, which would also deflate their value.
Seems legit. Seems like...
It's actually the opposite. It's a misleading lie.
What we need is not a greater understanding of economics, but a worse understanding of economics in order to really move forward.
Maybe you're true.
Because there's
a
dogma there. There's a
Yeah, maybe this is true because our comrades on the left, the way that we talk about neoliberalism as this ideology of commodification has commodified every aspect of our life, and
the problem is that we haven't commodified enough. I don't know if I have anything to follow that up with.
Perhaps what we need to do is commodify real value, like the care of a mother for her children.
Clean air.
Yes. If we commodify these things, the true value to humans, not this abstract gray economic value we currently... Maybe the problem is our gray economic value is not neoliberal enough. It's not commodified enough. But maybe also by submitting to the logic of economics, we're deepening the potential for suffering. And the action is the opposite, which is to embrace the fact that a mother's care for her children is not commodified within our system. We can say, oh, this is creating real value. This may not be economic value, but it has something valuable to society. And perhaps that we should be universalizing that rather than money. So what we have to do is take the non-monetary value aspect of like a friend helping a friend move, a mother raising her children, or someone creating a new vaccine and then not patenting it and making it universally available. That type of real value, that non-commodified value, that non-monetary value should be universalized, and we should distance ourselves from the flawed social science of economics, which limits our imagination and our ability to help one another.
Oh man, all this economics talk, it just got me thinking about taxation is theft, the libertarian common sense wisdom of taxation is theft, and how I think that it might be actually exactly the opposite, and that to not tax is to steal, because of just this economic disparity that we have right now is a theft, that the current situation is a situation of theft. The fact of the inequality is the theft. And so to not attempt to rectify that inequality by redistributing wealth from the top to the bottom is to participate in the theft that already exists, is to be complicit in the structural theft that is already there. So taxation is actually precisely the opposite of theft, if it's done well.
This reminds me of in Marxism, you have this idea of the workers leading a revolution. And I think it's the opposite in both forms. The workers' revolution will fail, but the non-workers' reforms will succeed to bring about communism. The traditional communist idea is that the leaders of the movement, the proletariat, the working people of a society, they get fed up with the capitalist wage relations, rise up against their bosses, and create a system of shared prosperity. The reality of this is the opposite, that as the capitalist system of distribution disenfranchises more and more people, pushes them out of working positions with the advent of technology, this growing section of society we call the precariat, the working person cannot revolt because they're too busy working. The person who leads the revolution is the non-working person, the person who's been pushed from their job. And it won't come in the form of a traditional revolution. It will come in the form of tweaking the existing system, pushing a cultural shift forward that the end goal of, the end result of, is indistinguishable from the end goal of perfect egalitarian communism that the Marxists dreamed for. So the Marxists have it the opposite. It's not a workers' revolution. It's a non-workers' reform.
Yeah, but maybe it's actually just the opposite of that, where what you are describing is the true workers' revolution, and what Marx was describing was not a workers' revolution, but was a form of reformism where you just take the same structure that exists and seize control of it as workers. What you're talking about is actually changing the structure is truly revolutionary. And so in order to understand it properly, we must realize that those concepts have been reversed, confused, systematically misunderstood from the beginning.
Now I see that I'm the confused liberal humanist. You're the truly revolutionary thinker in this example. The common conception you run into around Jar Jar Binks, the character from Star Wars Episode I, widely conceived of by confused liberal humanists as a pox on the series, a negative aspect. What I claim is that Jar Jar Binks is exactly the opposite, the peak of the series, the artistic apex of the series. He's thought of as, oh, this is 20th Century Fox trying to sell toys, make more toys, create new characters to sell toys. I would claim it's actually the exact opposite. It came from within George. It was not, oh, the shadowy bureaucracy of this enormous movie-making hierarchy quashing the artist. No, in this instance, it was in fact the artist expressing himself as fully as he wanted to, and it was the fans who punished him, not the organization. On the other hand, Jar Jar Binks to the fans represents the loss of innocence, not only in the character himself, but is also to our audience, who is now understanding that the fantasy world of Star Wars is that a fantasy, and as they are no longer a children, it is time to face reality.
Yes, and so too, there is a common wisdom that wearing socks with sandals is an atrocious fashion choice, but I claim that the reality is just the opposite, that unlike shoes, which are often uncomfortable without socks, sandals are a liberatory footwear that allow the user to choose whether or not to wear socks. Wearing socks with your sandals can help keep your toes warm, can keep your feet protected, can keep bugs from biting them. And the idea that you cannot wear socks with sandals is the most insidious, corrupt, puritanical idea that prevents us from having true footwear liberation.
In the same sense, Comic Sans MS, the font, it is criticized. He used Comic Sans MS on a sign. This is a child's font. What are you doing? I would claim we should embrace these moments where people are using the Comic Sans MS font. It is a representative of the world of children, of the child in all of us. And when someone chooses to use this font, what they're showing us is that they long for that innocence and play once again. It's imperative on us in those moments to not, as we've been doing, play the adult. We must, in a sense, be post-Oedipal. We think of our job as the shushing adult to tell, no, you must not use this font. It makes you look as a child. No, what we should be saying is thumbs up. I love you. You're a beautiful child and I'll take care of you. Or I'm a child too. I'll either take care of you or I'm also a child playing with you.
Or both.
In that same sense, in popular culture, we attack the spork as an attempt to be random. The comedy of the spork is its randomness. My claim would be that actually it's the opposite is true. There's nothing less random than the spork. The spork is a perfect embodiment of the ruling ideology of increased efficiency, of portability. We don't have room to carry both forks and spoons. We must create the spork in between to further optimize. The spork is not something random to say. It is the most logical thing to say at any given time. The merger of the fork and the spoon is pure ideology.
And likewise, there is the common conception that the Simpsons first 9 seasons were the only good seasons, and since then it has been on an irreversible downward trend. And I say that the claim is exactly the opposite. The Simpsons now is better than it ever has been before. The episodes being produced right now are the most inspired, most funny, most poignant, most satirically sharp comedy to exist in the world today. No, the new Simpsons are actually terrible. Who are we kidding? The audio quality on this next little clip is pretty terrible, but it is worth it. It's a clip of an interviewer asking Noam Chomsky a question about Zizek.
And then what are your thoughts on Slavoj Zizek's work with regards to how much of it you're aware of or have read or engaged with? And then his use of French psychoanalyst Lacan's work, and then, of course, any words on Derrida's work, deconstructionism, and that legacy?
what you're referring to is what's called theory. And the reason when I said I'm not interested in theory, what I meant is I'm not interested in posturing, using fancy terms like polysyllables and pretending that theory when you have no theory whatsoever. So there's no theory in any of this stuff, not in the sense of theory that anyone's familiar with in the sciences or any other serious field. Try to find in all of the work you mentioned some principles from which you can deduce conclusions that yield empirically testable propositions. Where it all goes beyond the level of something you can explain in 5 minutes to a 12-year-old. See if you can find that when the fancy words are decoded. I can't. So I'm not interested in that kind of posturing. Zizek is an extreme example of it. I don't see anything in what he's saying.
Well, with all deep respect that I do have for Chomsky, my first point is that Chomsky, who always emphasizes how one has to be empirical, accurate, not just some crazy Lacanian speculations and so on. Well, I don't think I know a guy who was so often empirically wrong in his descriptions, in his whatever. I remember when he defended this demonization of Khmer Rouge. And he wrote a couple of texts claiming, no, this is Western propaganda, Khmer Rouge are not as horrible as that. And when later he was compelled to admit that Khmer Rouge were not the nicest guys in this universe and so on, his defense was quite shocking for me. It was that, no, with the data that we had at that point, I was right. At that point, we didn't yet know enough, so, you know. But I totally reject this line of reasoning. For example, concerning Stalinism. The point is not that you have to know, you have to photo evidence of Gulag or whatever. My God, you just have to listen to the public discourse of Stalinism, of Khmer Rouge, to get it that something terrifyingly pathological is going on there.
Aaron, I was wondering if you thought, is there any better example of modern capitalist ideology than the truck nuts phenomenon?
Oh God, I don't know. I don't know if truck nuts are a capitalist phenomenon or if they are an anti-capitalist phenomenon, a middle finger to the idea of consumerism by being so precisely ridiculous in what they are. They are exposing the mediocrity of commodification, and so their function in society is actually an anti-capitalist function.
It strikes me that they fit into my theory that one of the repressive forces of our society is that men have a larger desire to show their testicles than society gives them options to.
Yeah, that definitely seems to be true. Based on there's not as much demand. And there's technically the same amount of supply, but a greater desire to show off that supply.
You know, it is anti-capitalist in a sense, because I think within the hegemony of advertising and popular culture, we treat testicles as the unsightly part of the penis, and what we celebrate is the phallus. And
yeah.
But in reality, the testicles are not only one of the most important functional parts. The erasure of the testicles is neoliberal capitalist ideology. The embracing of the testicles is pure, you know, working class anti-capitalism. It stands up against this idea, because even in reality, people do find testicles attractive. They'll compliment testicles and they'll
snuggle up with testicles.
In reality, if we are separated from the false consciousness of the advertising industry, the testicles are one of the sexiest parts of the male form. And so in this sense, truck nuts is exactly the opposite of capitalist ideology. It's as you said, a middle finger, a fight against the ruling class powers.
It's against the strict focus on the phallus, and it's a focus on life and what makes life possible, and the production of sperm that happens in the testicles, and it's a celebration of that, and it's a rebuke of the capitalist anti-life machinery that is functioning in society today. It's saying yes to life instead of no to life.
Yeah, and this ideology of the attack on one's body that the bodies that we're born with, if we have hairs in between our eyebrows, or if we have something like uneven breasts or having testicles at all, these are all seen as deviations from what capitalism expects from our bodies. Rather than having capitalism fit our bodies, we've made it so with the advertising industry and popular culture hegemony, media culture has convinced us that our bodies are insufficient. And Truck Nuts is a bold strike against this system of ruling class ideology. When people see Truck Nuts, they see them as undignified, stepping out of order, and so on. But if we check the historical record, the idea of stepping out of order in such a way was thought the same way of people who fought for desegregation or the end of slavery. And in that sense, the Truck Nuts are revolutionary. They refuse to play to the public opinion manufactured by the elites.
Or maybe it's precisely the opposite. And by refusing to play the game in the area of Truck Nuts, we are deviating the righteous energy, the righteous anti-system, anti-establishment energy away from noble pursuits like desegregation and towards idiotic pursuits such as Truck Nuts.
If the Truck Nut struggle is so small that it doesn't register on the same radar and therefore is rounded down to zero instead of rounded up to one, if it's rounded down to zero, then you're correct. But I'm tempted to say it's rounded up to one.
Maybe the problem is with the rounding itself. And what we need to be doing is looking at decimal places and looking at fractions and appreciating the inner depths of things and not trying to gloss everything up into a one or a zero, but to admit that 0.23s are worth talking about and so are 1.5s and everything above and below and in between.
But maybe what we need to do is go the opposite way and round up further. If we accept that we're choosing to round as it stands, then perhaps to continue or accelerate this logic will achieve the ends that we wish to achieve better. So thinking in terms of fives or tens, 20s or hundreds might be the more revolutionary numerical option than regressing to decimals and fractions.
I've long been an advocate for sometimes just squinting at things and not getting too lost in the details and just trying to get an overall picture. So in that sense, I definitely see the value of the lower resolution of rounding further and further up rather than digging deeper and deeper down. Maybe what should be contentious here is the very basic assumption behind what we've been saying this whole time and has gone unchallenged, which is that rounding and digging deeper down into looking at the decimal places need to be pitted against one another at all.
I was thinking the same thing. If these premises, these competing contradictory premises, are seen as non-rivalrous, perhaps the ideology of rivalry is pushing us further away from being able to discern the truth.
I don't know, though. I think maybe it's not the ideology of rivalry, but it's the ideology of not accepting rivalry, of wanting to be on one side of a rivalry rather than expanding to include the rivalry rather than trying to resolve it. That the desire to resolve it is what shrinks us down into being on one side or the other, whereas we can take the energy of the rivalry and use it towards a positive end when we are bigger than it, when we can see both sides of it and utilize both the energies of both. And the ideology that needs to be rebuked is the ideology that everything needs to be resolved.
That there needs to be an integration between the rivalrous positions.
In place of the integration is the acceptance of the rivalry. It's an integration in a form that we would not have recognized initially. It's an integration where there is an acceptance of the tension within it.
This brings me to, I think, one of the most important points of today, which is the idea of this naive liberal humanist idea, this social democratic idea of we are all one, we are all the same. All humanity is one. In the same way that you were just outlining, it's not that we are an integrated whole, it's that we are a pluralistic whole. It's not that we're all one. Our value is the opposite. Our value is the fact that we are all different. The value is that we are separate and unequal, and that we contain difference and plurality and multiplicity, and a true integration of that would not try to blur the lines of us, and in the same sense, embrace that tension, acknowledge that tension, acknowledge the differences, acknowledge the sectarianism, acknowledge all of that. So in some naive sense, yes, we are all one, but on a deeper sense, we're all individuals, we're many.
And of course, as we discussed earlier, it is precisely by being individuals in the context of the whole that we have our own identity. A is A because A is A within the context of the entire alphabet, and we are ourselves one single individual because we are in the context of the one larger whole, and we are a reflection of it, and we are at least partially defined by our context within it, and the two are inextricably linked.
We can't say that A is A without acknowledging the tension between A and B. We're taught the alphabet is a song, that we sing the song from start to together. It fits together in perfect harmony. I would say the opposite. The alphabet is a cacophony of random and contradictory noise that is divided against itself. There is no pattern to the progression of the alphabet. The sounds that they make in relation to other letters, also random. This is pure chaos, and to call this a song or to claim it's in harmony, I think is wrong. There is a tension in the alphabet. In that same sense, there's a tension between human beings. There's a tension between contradictory ideas when they're being integrated that, if it's ignored, makes naive analysis.
Welcome to Keyboard Warrior Radio Theater.
As I sit here watching you make terrible point after terrible point, it occurs to me that what you and I are doing right now, participating in this keyboard warrior debate, is precisely the reason that we're both so mad at each other, and that it's not the tension between us, but our failure to acknowledge the tension between us, to accept the tension between us and live it, where we get into this false keyboard warrior stance of opposition, where what we need is a dynamic tension instead.
The conventional logic would be that we're angry about those who disagree with us, and we have this outlet to get angry at each other across the internet. This existing anger and passion has been funneled into this new medium. If I understand you correctly, your claim is that it's the opposite, that the anger and conflict is the shape of the container, the nature of participating in this medium, and that we've come in with views that, while they contain tension, aren't reflective or connected to the anger, which is sourced at the medium of expression.
That is what I was saying, but now I'm starting to think that it might be exactly the opposite, and that it's not that the source of our anger is within the medium of keyboard warrioring, but the problem is that we project the source of our anger into the medium rather than accepting the responsibility for that anger ourselves and for discovering why it is that we refuse dynamism and seek a false resolution or seek a false submission, where I want you to submit to me and you want me to submit to you, rather than accepting that dynamism.
I think we also have to interrogate what is meant when someone says a warrior. If we mean that competing sides are going into a battle of ideas and seeking victory through conflict, perhaps a comparison can be made. But crucially, an element of the warrior in all cultures is an honor system, and is not this internet culture of violence and slurs and attacking the person rather than the ideas and so on. This is barbarianism. It's not warriors. A true keyboard warrior would not behave so, not just violently, but crudely violent. Violent without aims, without integrity, and without honor. Perhaps what we need is a keyboard warrior in a land of keyboard barbarians.
I think, in addition, conversely, we must admit to ourselves that there is truth in the dirt, and that slinging mud is sometimes the best way to get the truth in people's eyes. And rather than having a narrow conception of what it means to be an honorable warrior, that we have to realize that part of being that honorable warrior is to be the barbarian. They are one and the same person. However, we need to find the dynamic tension between them. We accept both of them, not one, not the other, but both playing the roles that they were born to play within the larger story of the debate. So rather than getting upset or down on people when they're slinging mud, we see that as a legitimate part of the whole, and we embrace the noble warrior, take the mud on our face, see the truth that's in the dirt, and bring it up to the level of dignity.
It's true that the barbarian and warrior exist in relation to one another, but we must differentiate between is and ought, because we ought to eradicate the barbarian and we ought to embrace and maximize the warrior. There's no inherent good in treating the two as interdependent, tense opposites. I would say no, we have to commit to eradicating the scourge of the barbarian.
My naive little friend, my naive little liberal humanist, it is precisely in what you are describing. When we believe ourselves to be righteously on the path towards the warrior ethos, when we reject the barbarian, is when the barbarian overtakes us. It is only through, yes, withholding that dynamic tension that we can ever consciously lean towards the warrior, because we truly understand and contain both. If we attempt to eliminate one of them from within us, to crush the barbarian entirely, the barbarian self within each of us will take over, because it is going unacknowledged, unexpressed as it takes over. So, my pitiful little fool, pitiful little liberal, it is within the tension that we can lean towards the one that is better.
And we'll see you next time for another episode of Keyboard Warrior Radio Theater.
That's another thing, problem that I have with this. We should hear everybody's his or their story from within and so on. This is why I think this is a typical superego injunction. No, you should understand everybody. It's not possible. So then you feel guilty. You are never up to the level. No, I think that, how should I put it, very brutally, but I think this is the only honest position. I don't want to understand everybody. I don't care about majority of the people. I think what we need today, when we are different cultures violently thrown together, I think we need, as Sloterdijk put it, a new code of discretion. We need more alienation. We need to learn to ignore each other. I don't think we need more to understand each other. This is, again, an impossible task which makes us forever guilty. But did you really understand? How did you know what I meant with that smile and so on? We should. This is typical liberal blackmail which we should reject.
So this has been the Seriously Wrong podcast, but in a sense, by not being it. By deviating from our original format and structure, what we've done is create the Seriously Wrong and define the Seriously Wrong by precisely avoiding what is seriously wrong.
In the avoidance, we have fulfilled the natural outcome of the pattern. We have taken Seriously Wrong to the point where it needed to be this thing now and express itself fully in this moment as what it is. And that has all been because we did not do what we have done before. It is exactly in the not doing that the doing was done.
Some listeners give us feedback. I prefer the episodes where you do a greater amount of research. I would claim no.
What you actually prefer.
What is enjoyable about this show? I want to thank everyone for using the contact form on our website and calling our toll-free hotline 1-866-770-8754 to ask us questions and give comments. And I would also thank those who have chosen not to do these things and have chosen not to send donations, because in a sense they're still participating, because they're doing by not doing, they're calling by not calling, messaging us by not messaging us.
For every person we have who donates, who comments, who participates, they must exist within the context of a much larger group of people who don't do any of those things. But the people who filter on down to us, who do want to leave messages on our phone line, ask us questions, have us do shows about their questions, people who do want to leave reviews about us on websites around, they only come to us because there is this larger group of people who aren't doing those things around them. They exist because of them. And so we thank you all for playing the parts that you play in that greater spectrum. There's no more or less morally right place to be in that spectrum, except that it is more morally right to do those things than not.
See, I would claim the opposite. To donate to us or call our phone line would be immoral. Everyone who donates to us is, in a sense, choosing to not donate somewhere else, perhaps where life-saving medication could be brought to children and so on. So in that sense, any donation to us is an evil omission of competing financial paradigm.
But in that same way, redirecting money that you were going to spend, say, on that fourth slice of pizza that you probably shouldn't have anyway.
Mm-hmm. And $5 Starbucks coffee.
Taking that and redirecting it to giving it to a much more worthy cause than us is a greater gain than redirecting any money that you have been giving to us. So it makes a lot more sense to keep giving the money to us and to change some other money towards a better cause, and to not to stop, don't stop on Patreon. We have a Patreon. If you're donating on it, please don't stop.
Yeah, if you're donating on PayPal, please don't stop.
We just added a new bonus show, and I've got a couple more coming down the pike.
Yeah, me too. Let's just say that bonus episode factory is pumping.
I'm gonna tease it a bit, and people hear it's the second episode we ever recorded. Has never been released because we didn't like it at the time, but now it's going to be in the bonus section. So this is a time capsule. This is the fourth time Sean and I ever hung out and had a conversation on tape. It's never been heard by anyone. We'll be in the bonus section at some point soon.
And it represents a time when we were both at different places in personal, political, emotional development, comes through on the recording. We're different people then.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
Yeah. So yeah, thank you for listening and playing along with us at home. If you did play along with us at home, that can be something you send to us, by the way.
Yeah. And in another sense, you're welcome for listening, because we've provided something for you.
It's precisely the opposite. They have provided something for us.
Oh yeah, and I just want to formally acknowledge that my Zizek impression isn't that great.
Oh, bad move. Everyone was like, oh, I thought it was really good, but if he says it's bad, it must be.
I hate him.
I like the show less now.
Removes Patreon from the cart.
Radiolab is far better produced. Maybe I'll give to them.
They do research every time.
You seem to be saying that there may not be a way to change. The people who are asking for change don't know what that change is, and so there will not be the change that...
But I'm a little bit more of an optimist, precisely, paradoxically, because I'm even more a pessimist. But the world is changing. I mean, capitalism today is no longer capitalism 20 years ago. So my first thing, when people say things cannot change, my answer to them is, but they are changing like crazy all around the world.
I am wrong. You are wrong. We are wrong. I am wrong. He is wrong. She is wrong. They are wrong. We are wrong. Seriously. Seriously. Seriously.
next time on the Seriously Wrong podcast is, in a sense, part of this time on Seriously Wrong, because the vast majority of people who ever listened to this podcast throughout the entire history of time have listened to episodes that didn't just come out. So in that sense, next time of Seriously Wrong is about to start right now.
It seems you just recently had a conversation with Angela Davis, and I would like to see more of those conversations take place, even from, say, folks coming from different angles, people such as yourself and, say, someone as Slavoj Žižek, whose work is becoming more influential. Do you think this is something we should think about?
Well, you say his work is becoming influential. I would question that. I think his posturing is becoming influential. Can you tell me what the work is? I can't find it. I mean, I see a lot of, he's good, he's a good actor. He makes things sound exciting, but can you find any content? I can't. So I would have no interest in having a conversation with him, and I suppose it's the converse is true as well, I imagine. But a discussion with Angela Davis is fine. She's an interesting person. Thinks about things, has important things to say, has done interesting things.